You're listening to the Oneofus.net podcast network.
Volume 1, Visit Planet Hulk!
We'll mash as many things as we can into this. Everything that we've been meaning to get to, it's all going to end up in this bucket that is called Thor Ragnarok.
Just the fun parts of Planet Hulk, though, not the depressing parts.
Yeah, well, that's true, although I will say, as much as this new film, the third film in the Thor series, is by far one of Marvel's most straight-up, just flat-out comedies, there's some super dark shit that happens in this as well.
Especially
if you're attached to some of the characters that have been represented more minorly in the Thor movies, but in the comics are huge characters.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You're kind of like, Jesus Christ, movie!
This does really feel like a clearing of the decks, going, all right, we've had two other Thor films to try to get this right.
Yeah.
We didn't quite nail it. We think we know what works now, but you know what? Let's just kind of give ourselves a soft reboot here.
Most of you people didn't embrace these characters enough, so fuck everybody who liked them.
Yeah. Look, damn it, we brought in Brana, we try to give you gravitas, we try to make this Shakespearean rather than, you know, feeling like it's some dopey thing about guys wandering around in, like, capes and shit.
Well, that's the thing.
No, that's not what you wanted.
Well, they replace him with Korg now.
Yeah. when you look at, like, the history of Thor comics, though, only some of it is like that Branagh type. Like, we're telling this is mythology and other stuff. Like, you read Walter Simonson's run and you're like, no, this guy had a real sense of humor about these. Like, look, this is ridiculous, so let's have fun here. And this movie seems to be, like, in fact, even calls out several Simonson bits here and there, references it. I'm like, yeah, I think this is the Thor movie we all actually really wanted to see.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I mean, they kind of in the first two, they were like kind of tongue in cheek, wink, wink, nod, nod about like, well, we're about gods, but we're kind of aliens and we're somewhat science fiction. And this one is just like, no, fuck you, it's science fiction.
I think this also really this is a post Guardians film.
I think
they went, you know, that
was working.
Why not just lean into that more?
But it is its own thing. Like, it also feels very different from aside from the humor, you know, they're very different.
Oh, yeah. I don't want to give the wrong impression. It's not a cookie-cutter thing.
There are definitely characters here that would not be out of place in a Guardians movie, but they feel perfectly at home.
And I think the Guardians could visit Sakaar.
And I feel this is not a coincidence either in terms of just, well, that seems like a good idea because the other two movies didn't really sell as well as we thought. As much as we've already heard strong suggestions that Thor will, when we see him again in Avengers, will be teamed up with the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Right.
So you kind of already put him in that sort of like lighter humor sort of way.
In defense of that first Thor film, which is the better of the first two.
Oh, yeah, and by far.
You know, it had a lot of good moments. Just casting Chris Hemsworth turned out to be a really smart choice.
Yeah.
And, you know, what it managed to do, and Guardians gets a lot of credit for this, but that first Thor film is really the first steps into the MCU, where it starts to get cosmic, the Marvel cosmic universe, I should say.
Expands past Earth.
It's got a huge bridge that can go anywhere in the world, in the universe.
And it's rainbow-colored and bright and colorful, and everything's gold, and people have, like, iridescent armor.
And here's an attractive physicist to explain it all to.
But again, I think they try to hedge their bets and go, but we have to ground it and make it kind of feel like you've earned this, you know. Somewhere along the line, everybody figured out, Chris Hemsworth is actually a funny guy. Why don't we just let him be funny?
Yeah, agreed. As well as a lot of the other talented people who are on this cast.
Yeah.
Certainly introducing a lot of new characters here into the storyline, including the villain, Cate Blanchett, as Hela, the goddess of death and Thor's and Loki's long-lost sister.
She looks awesome.
Who looks amazing.
Great guy.
Who they not only made, first off,
Cate Blanchett is incredibly well-designed.
She is. She knows how to work that suit,
yes,
is all
she
I'm saying.
Does.
But is not only like just a well-defined, cool villain with cool abilities, but also makes the most out of being funny in this movie at points.
Yeah, everybody in here, and it actually does a really good job of of being funny and still having gravitas and still having really good stakes, and that you're like, there are plenty of oh shit moments in this movie.
Well, the basic idea, starting off here, without getting into too much details, because there's so many just fun surprises, after an initial sort of like, okay, now here we're going to set the tone by basically Thor like openly calling out previous Marvel films on the whole, I'm going to intentionally let myself get captured.
It opens up like an episode of Arrested Development. Yeah, well, I bet you're wondering how I got here.
I'm surprised they didn't get Ron Howard to go. No, he didn't. but he returns to Asgard to, you know, as we saw in a previous film, Loki has been posing as Odin, which leads to much hilarity here, including a very funny series of cameos. But immediately, of course, it's like, look, I'm not an idiot. I know you're not Odin. Okay, but stop that shit right away. And says, look, we need to find Odin. You're going to help me. Only to find that Odin's like, you're on your own, prick. Yeah. And by the way,
I've been carrying you kids for centuries.
Peace.
Peace out.
Yeah, I'm out.
Yes, we can only afford to have Sir fucking Anthony Hopkins appear in 20 minutes of this film.
But if that. But then he's like, oh yeah, and by the way, your sister's coming and you're fucked. So have fun. Good luck with that. Can't help you. And almost immediately she kicks the shit out of them and sends them hurtling outside of the Rainbow Bridge
into Planet Hulk.
Into Planet Hulk.
If you guys had just hung yourself and let a raven eat your eyeball, you would have seen this coming.
Which is, in this particular variation on it, this version of Planet Hulk is actually the Grandmaster's world, where he pulls in, like, the world's biggest arena sport, where he kidnaps great warriors to fight, and his current big warrior is Hulk.
The elders of the universe are this kind of quintet of just, like, oddball, like, Jack Kirby was taking a shit one day. Yeah. He thought, oh, I've got an idea, a guy that he wants to box everyone in the universe. So it's always a question of like, well, how should we play these guys and how are they going to fold into the universe? And apparently their idea is just get good actors and tell them to camp it the fuck up.
And right? No question getting Jeff Goldblum to play Grandmaster was a inspired
oh, God. I feel they just like cranked him up and let him go. And he just said shit and they were like, all right, we'll take it. It's like whatever. He says it's funny.
You know how you're Jeff Goldblum? Well, we want Jeff Goldblum at 11.
Imagine if Jeff Goldblum was immortal.
That's what the script said. Jeff Goldblum. It's just let him go.
Super Jeff Goldblum.
In fact, they probably just called him Jeff in the script. Yeah. And then Jeff comes in and says,
it says Jeff, do your thing.
The next half page are just for you. Do it.
But then they also introduced Tessa Thompson as the last surviving Valkyrie, which is cool. I always wondered when they were going to bring Valkyrie into the Marvel Universe, and she's a great choice. And I think she just fits really so well.
And there are a lot of little shout outs to the character that those who grew up in the 70s and 80s came to love in the Defenders run.
Yeah, she's probably not going to end up on the Defenders. Though.
No, I'm thinking not. Although that would be awesome.
And, you know, out of that, Carl Urban returns as Scourge, who gets some interesting stuff.
As Baldy, being bald and frowning the whole movie.
That was a weak point for me because, yeah.
He have a character arc, or will he just be bald and frowning?
He really didn't. There was never really any explanation for, why are you here, and why is Hela dealing with you at all?
They needed a story.
The writers needed a character that Hela could talk to.
They really?
She could have monologued.
She did a great job talking to herself.
One of the high points in here is, like, of course, Thor and Hulk, who interact quite a bit in here. And, you know, there is a period where he becomes Mark Ruffalo, which is one of my favorite lines in the whole thing. It's like, because the Hulk is all punchy and useful. He's like, yeah, but I've got all the science stuff. I'm useful. He's like, are you?
Think about it.
You know, Mark Ruffalo is his own best special effect, though, after multiple Hulk iterations. Again, similar to Thor, they're like, you know, we can let the guy be funny. It's an inherently ridiculous situation. Let's have some fun with it.
And this is, thank God, this is the first one where they're just like, Hulk can talk. He's always been able to talk. He drops a couple of personal pronouns here and there, but he can talk.
Yeah, they're playing him as an angry toddler, basically. Or angry like 6-year-old,
which is Hulk.
Yeah, which is Hulk. Well, at least until he turns into like Mr. Fix-It or some shit.
Yeah, don't give me.
Which I would be all for, to be fair. But yeah, there's so much going on here. The movie moves so fast. I mean, really, the plot it moves at hyper.
It has ADHD. It is so. It's from one thing. Like I said, I felt like I was reading like comics, like a 6-issue arc, because it moves from piece set piece to set piece.
Yeah, it doesn't waste any time hanging around too long, even with the moments that, like I said, get dark, or you would think another person would go, well, this scene needs to have more gravitas. They're like, okay, that happened. Let's move past
that. We killed that guy off.
And you're for a moment, you're like, really? And then you're like, oh, fuck it, I'm having fun.
Yeah. Shit's bright and shiny and looks cool.
Yeah, exactly.
This brought me back to being like 12 years old at the convenience store, loading up on Dr. Pepper and Sixlets and playing video games and staring at the artwork that is so elaborate and beautiful. And then you look over at the 8-bit pixelated version of the story that you were promised on the side of that arcade game. This, finally, they have the technology to make those crazy illustrations come to life.
Absolutely.
This is like a bunch of Jack Kirby drawings with a bunch of arcade art, yes, album covers, and just as much sugar as you can inject into your system. It is blissful. Even the garbage planet is wonderfully colorful.
Yeah. It's a CG fest to be sure, but it's not a shit show. Like, the fight scenes are actually really cool. Like, I like the fight scenes in this better than the climax in the latest Guardians.
Okay.
I thought there were like a lot of like, where you feel like, oh, these characters are hitting each other. I mean, you know it's CG. Yeah.
Well, that whole thing, when you put the Thor versus Hulk together, which in the Marvel Universe is always the best fight there is.
Yeah.
You know, you put the two, it's like uncertain who's going to win.
Yeah.
They can just pound the shit out of each other in like enormous ways and both go,
that one's done.
You know? And it's a lot of fun to watch. Can I point out as well how great it is to see Tom Hiddleston full on in this movie again as Loki? That whole Thor-Loki relationship of like, man, you're my brother. I want to love you, but you're such a dick.
You know, and he's like real brothers.
And he's like, yeah, but I am a dick, but I'm the best dick. I'm the best dick you
know. But you can weaponize my dick chip.
He's so great.
None of those are actual lines from the movie, by the
way. But they might as well.
Tom Hiddleston never says, I'm the best dick. But, you know, I'm sure some ladies would think he is.
There are some.
There's a lot of eye candy in this movie.
There's a little bit of dick jokes here and there.
There's almost like some naked Hulk eye candy here. So it's like, I cannot unsee that.
If you've been a shipper.
Yeah, there you go. I also wanted to point out here, Taika Waititi himself, the director, who of course did the, if you haven't seen What We Do in the Shadows yet, God damn it, go watch that movie.
Of 2014.
It's kind of like, I'm starting to have seen like 7 times now. I'm kind of like putting it in that A Fish Called Wanda category for me.
Sure.
I'm like, this is one of the all-time great comedies.
But his other work, like Hunt for the Wilder People,
which is also terrific.
Which is also very funny, but has a lot of heart.
Yeah.
And he really gets to play both parts of that in this movie.
Well,
he does have the heartfelt moments, but he also leans into the absurd.
And he's actually voicing one of the characters in here, Korg, who's like a gladiator, becomes friends with Thor, who gets some of the best lines in the entire film. For sure.
He's just
him and his little sidekick.
Guy with knives for hands.
Yeah. It's like, this is my friend. He's got knives for hands.
Okay.
That's all you really need to know about him.
Well, they're better than the Thor characters that got killed off in the first
Kind of are. Those are always like, this multicultural group of tough warriors.
You guys you guys can shut your filthy whore mouth. I love Volstagg, and you guys can go suck.
Yeah, are you talking about the comic version or the movie version?
I think the movie version had its points. They didn't run far enough with it, but I felt that he did a good job of bringing Volstagg to the stage.
Without spoiling anything, let's just say Asgard has gotten kind of crowded. They figured out a way to move Thor and his buddies into a whole new realm. Let's see where they go.
There were times that I was just like, wait a minute, aren't you a mighty warrior culture? Oh, okay, I guess they killed all those guys.
Look, sometimes that's what you got to do if you want Vikings in space, Bo.
That's true.
You just got a clean house.
It's a small price to pay.
So I do think this is fun. Stephen Strange, Doctor Strange, Benedict Cumberbatch has one of the funniest sequences in this entire movie, which if you've seen the trailers, you've probably seen the bulk of what is actually happening plot-wise. It's only like maybe 5 minutes in the movie, but it's really laugh-out-loud.
But it's Cumberbatchy is all batch.
It really is. I love that it shows that,
I was surprised they put him in the trailer.
This is enough time passed the first Doctor Strange that he's a lot better at what he does now. Like, and hyper confident, as it were. He is the Tony Stark of magic, as he was always meant to be.
Indeed.
Awesome but, facial hair twins.
But without without further ado, let's go and get to the final thoughts and start with you, Zach.
Well, I really like this movie, but I think the pacing is a little too frenetic. It's very fast. I could have let some of the scenes kind of simmer a little bit more and let the characters, you know, die and have a little bit more remorse for them. It's still great, and I do like all the candy that's being thrown at me. But I think I'll give it 8 out of 10 roots on, what is it? The Yggdrasil tree?
Yggdrasil, yeah.
Yggdrasil.
Yggdrasil tree.
Marco?
Well, you know, as has been pointed out by Zach, it is a little moment. There are some moments you got, you know, you could actually slow down here and, you know, let us bask in this world a little bit, but there's no time for that. This feels like a very transitional film. They needed to make a Thor movie. It's a way to connect some dots for some upcoming things. And they're like, if it's going to be filler, let's at least make it fun. Let's go out on a high. Let's switch up Thor's game and create a whole new story for him. I totally enjoyed it. I think you will too. Drink a lot of fucking sugary drinks, folks, because you're going to need it. And then, or don't. It depends on you.
The movie is a sugary drink.
It is a sugary drink, you know. So I would give this 8.5 out of 10 hammers.
Beau?
Yeah, there are going to be some people that are going to be grumpy about this one and be like, well, you took the gravitas out of Thor, blah-de-blah, and you made it a joke. And I don't care because, yeah, I think it's a very great point that this is a transitional movie. And unlike Age of Ultron, this is held really well because they get their transitions done while having a really fun roller coaster, you know, arcade run. And I probably laughed more in this movie than I have laughed in any movie, which is kind of surprising because I think between Ant-Man and Guardians of the Galaxy, everybody knows by now there's lots of laughs we had in the MCU, but man, this had me gut busting more than a couple of times. So kudos to that. Great action sequences. Yeah, there's some nitpicks here. Like I said, I felt like Scourge was kind of brought in and you know. Like, that for me, he's not the greatest character in the world, but I was waiting to see him in Enchantress team up.
He is really there just to, so Hela has someone
pretty
to talk
much.
To.
And, you know, don't do that to Carl Urban. He's Carl Urban. Cherish him like the rare resource that he
put him
is.
In a mega city outfit and exactly. Let him loose.
but yeah, I definitely, this was a really, really fun ride. It was pretty much everything that it was advertised to be, you know, from the moment that we first saw that trailer, it was like, oh my god, this is going to be the giant arcade video game of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and it sure the fuck was, and I really had a blast doing it. I give it 8.5 trips to Aladdin's Castle out of 10.
It was called Aladdin's Castle? We're in Texas, too?
No, Aladdin's Castle, that was a nationwide chain. Yeah.
Okay, I didn't realize that.
And they took all your quarters in the 80s and early 90s until Nintendo came.
Yeah, and until I beat up their Dragon's Lair machine, just like the kid from Stranger Things.
Yeah. Overpriced piece of shit.
Yeah, I think you guys have said what there is to be said here. It's glorious to look at. Marvel's gotten so good at comedy now that it's almost like, I imagine at some point, someone's going, well, are we ever going to do a different type of film again? It's like, it's scary to go away because we're so good. We've gotten into this niche where this is what we do better than anybody and maybe we should stick to it. Whereas like, hey, Fox is doing horror. Let them do that with New Mutants. Maybe we should stick to comedy. All I can say is there is something special about the comedy here versus Guardians of the Galaxy in that we are really seeing all these characters we already know interact with each other and make jokes with things like, I get that reference.
Right.
I understand that reference. And there's tons of even like Easter eggs for hardcore fans throughout this thing that if you don't catch, you're not going to know you missed them. And it's the fights are great. The performances are really top notch. Like I said, once again, that they Marvel seems they've gotten over that curse of not having good villains. It's like, oh wow, last several films in a row they've had really great villains, and this is no exception. I had just so much fun with this. This is the type of gloriously manic superhero film I love the most, and I'm gonna give it 9 out of 10 nice haircuts. One note for people who are staying for the end scenes, not to spoil anything, but both of them, neither one are like, a lot of times they go like, I was expecting them to do a Black Panther one, because yeah. A lot of the times, like, oh, here's a little sneak of the next film coming up. And this one is both of the, there is one right at that mid credits and there's one at the very end, and both of them are just sort of like little tail end bits to this movie, basically, with a possible
there's a little tease. For me, it was a fairly big sub.
That might be teasing something with Captain Marvel.
It depends on how much credulity you have to the theory.
Indeed. But either way, Hulk smash, Thor smash, everyone smash, Tessa Thompson smash. This is going to be a smash. That's all I got. So, unless someone's got something funnier.
Nope.
Which I can't imagine.
I just want to say, this is the one review. This review holds the record for the most time any of us said the word gravitas.
Oh, yeah. By the way, Mark Musburro did the music. Yeah, and as Marco pointed out, one of the first Marvel films that you're like, wow, I really want to own this soundtrack.
It sounded like Survive.
I think we said that about both the Guardians movies.
Those are the scores.
Yeah.
It has a distinctive feel to it.
And it's pretty damn good.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oneofus.net has been your one-stop shop for all things geek for years. But there's a side to them many of you have never heard. The subscription side. Subscribe and listen to great podcasts like The Breakfast Club, The Original Gentleman, and the Watch a Movie With Us series. Head on over to oneofus.net. And don't forget your towel.